Hi guys, today I am working on this watercolor painting and we're going to talk about what it takes to paint it. I'm just going to break down the technique and the process that I use to get to the final painting on this. It's been a little while, I think, since I've just talked about purely technique, and I love talking about it. I love watercolor painting, so it'll be fun just to break it down and remember what it takes to just create a painting like this. I do have a quick announcement though. This painting is part of the Citrine tier package. I love how it turned out and I love how she looks with the exclusive postcard and the other print that will also be in this package as well. So if you'd like to have all three of these prints mailed right to your door plus a sticker, then make sure to sign up for the Citrine tier over on my Patreon before the end of February 28th. And if you'd like just the postcard, you can sign up for the Malachite tier. That's $10 over there. But I have a link down in the description that'll take you over to my Patreon where you can check that out. And let's go ahead and jump into talking about this painting. The first step that I almost always do in my paintings is to paint the skin. That's where the eye usually goes first. You look at the character, and if I make a mistake there, I want to be able to either remedy it quickly so I can keep that momentum in the piece, or if it's bad enough, I can start over and make sure that that turns out right. Because in a lot of other areas, if I make a mistake, like in the background or in clothing, I can either find a way to work around it and cover it up, or it's can be less noticeable, but in the skin, it's a lot more in your face. So I like to get that done and ready and out of the way, and then I can move on. For this, I did a single wash first to make sure that it was just establishing the basic value. I also left areas of white where that would be the kind of a rim lighting effect, and that would be the highest highlight for her skin. And then it's time for me to start putting in some shadows. I like to start off with that same color that I used to create that base wash, and I can just establish where the shadows are going to fall. This keeps it really subtle and it helps me to build it up slower at least than just jumping right in with a darker shadow color. And then after I've established that, I will mix up a shadow paint color, and then I go in and add the deeper, darker areas. I love using quinacridone violet for this. This is what I'm using here. That's all it is on its own. I think that it creates a really beautiful shadow color to a lot of other paints that I use for the more base colors for skin. It just marries really nicely. And then I just continue building up that shadow color. With this, with the quinacridone violet, because I'm just using that same color again for this second wash on top, it becomes a little bit more purple and more saturated where I layer that on. So it works really well for, again, those deeper shadows. And as I'm working on these shadows, they tend to get smaller in certain areas so that there's kind of almost a cel-shaded effect in certain places depending on what that shadow actually needs. But that just helps it create almost a gradient look to the eye. And then some areas where there's just a strong cast shadow, I will just go back over the entire area that I painted the shadows down earlier. Like where the hair is falling over her face, that area has a cast shadow, so that ends up having a nice sharp line against the shadow because that entire path of the light is being stopped by the hair. And then it's time to start working on the hair. I love painting hair. It's so pleasant and satisfying to work on. But again, the process is it's pretty much exactly like painting the skin. I start off with a base color where I can establish the brightest highlights by leaving the paper white, at least at first. And here today, I'm painting your hair kind of this minty green color. And as I paint more shadows that end up being a little bit bluer, the overall look of the hair tends to shift a little bit bluer. So that's something to keep in mind when you're planning out your colors and which ones you're going to use for shadows and which ones for your main values. You want to make sure that the end goal is what you want, where oftentimes I've found with watercolors, if I don't plan exactly how I'm going to mix the shadow colors beforehand, those can tend to really tip the scale of how a color looks in the end, and it can make what I thought was going to be green hair actually end up looking much more like teal hair, or even sometimes more like a blue hair that has a little bit of green highlight. So yes, I always suggest that it's a good idea to do little color swatches where you can test out all the colors that you're going to use and how they layer together and how they end up looking together. And then it's time to start building up the shadows. For this, I did keep it pretty close in color family, a little bit more so than I did in the skin, where the skin had that almost complementary color for the shadow. This one just has more of an analogous color for the shadow, and that keeps it a little bit more harmonious, which I like for the hair. But yeah, it just ends up being a process of building layer after layer of those shadows. And this goes for any area when you're working on watercolors, but you want to make sure that the area is completely dry before you add the next layer, unless you're working specifically with like a wet on wet technique, which I am not right now. I've done that before in the past where I start painting on top of an area like a shadow that I think is dry, but it's not actually, and then it bleeds out and it can ruin the wash before it, and then it can also ruin that wash. So it is a good idea to check every once in a while, especially on larger areas, to make sure that it's thoroughly dry before you add that next shadow shape. And then I'm going to go in with my final pass on the shadows for this piece, in the hair, that is. And this is just a much more blue, dark mixture that I've created of the hair. So this is just really those areas that have the least amount of light, that really fall and recede. I love adding these areas in specific because they do really help a piece become much more alive feeling and more three-dimensional once you really push the shadows back. This is something that I can absolutely get better at, but I'm slowly pushing myself more as far as making sure that the shadows are dark enough and there's enough contrast there. But when you can achieve enough contrast in pieces like this, it tends to really liven it up so that it does feel more realistic that way. The background is probably my favorite thing to work on in this specific piece. I went in with a wet on wet wash, and I think that I used entirely Daniel Smith Moon Glow for this really smoky, hazy look. I love this paint. It's really beautiful. It ends up being overall kind of this gray color, but it granulates to these blues and purples that are really, really pretty, and it creates a lot of dimension to the piece, but it still is basically a gray color. So I love using it for areas like this where I want it to feel misty and foggy and a little bit stormy. So to create this look, I just went in with first just water, and it's a careful balance of putting too much water on your paint or on your paper, or not enough water on your paper. So this is something that you could absolutely do a lot of tests on a scratch piece of paper to make sure that you're getting enough water so that the paint flows the way that you want it to, but also it, basically, so it does what you want it to an extent. With the wet on wet, it's just so fun to be able to see what the paint itself wants to do and how it wants to behave. And this is just kind of a give and take process too, where you can go in and drop clean water on top of areas where there might be a little bit too much paint, or you just want to push it around a little bit. You can also go in with more pigmented paint in certain areas so that it creates a darker color and it mingles with what's already there. So I like to actually hop around on the piece as it's slowly drying, where I can just add a little bit more of, again, the water or the paint, and then that creates a really interesting look. I love it. So it's something you can play a lot with as far as figuring out what you can get out of different techniques, different ways of dropping in the paint and spreading it around. And I wanted the branches to marry with the background a little bit more, so I actually used that same paint, the Daniel Smith Moon Glow, to paint the branches that are coming out of the character. I made sure that the branches that are closer to the viewer were darker and the ones that were farther away were lighter, so that it does have this atmospheric effect. So it looks like there's this mist between us and those branches, and I love how that ended up looking. This paint can be a little bit tricky to work with when I'm wanting to create something a little bit more tangible like the branches. It works wonderfully for wet on wet, but it actually does lift up really easily in my experience. So when I want to add more glazes to darken a color, or when I want to go in and create shadows, it can be a little bit trickier, and I find that I have to be a little bit more delicate with my brush work so that I don't lift up that layer below it with the brush as I'm applying that next layer. So yes, that's just something to keep in mind, that it's can be tricky. It can be something to, again, get a little bit of practice with. And I do have this original painting as well as the other two that you see next to me available at my shop. There's a link down in the description that'll take you over there. And these three prints will actually be the postcard and the exclusive prints for my Patreon for this month, for February. So if you'd like to get these exclusively mailed to you, then there is a link down in the description that'll take you over to my Patreon. You just have to make sure that you're signed up for the Citrine tier over on Patreon before the end of February 28th, and then I will send them out to you. I'm really excited how these turned out and how they look together. So yeah, I do want to give a huge thank you to all of my patrons. As always, you guys are absolutely incredible. I can't thank you enough for the support that you show me over there. But that's it for today. So I'll be back with another art video next time. Thanks for watching.